morning and welcome to St. Vincent de Paul Church, a community united in faith. My name is Walsa George and the second lecturer is Ashley Gibson. Today we celebrate the third Sunday of Easter. Please silence your cell phones. Our celebrant for this Mass is Monsignor Bill. Today's second collection is for St. Jude Fund, which care for the poor and the needy.
Please rise and join us in singing our opening hymn, At the Lamb's High Feast We Sing, number 536 in your worship aid and also found in your gathering hymnal.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Today's gospel narrative shows us the rehabilitation of Peter, who denied Christ three times in the courtyard of Caiaphas, repented, and then received primacy in the church from Jesus. The gospel also shows God in search of men, even when many try to evade him. As we gather as a community on this third Sunday of Easter, may we heed the last spoken word that Jesus said to Peter. Follow me. Lord Jesus, you are the Lamb that was slain, setting us free from sin. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you saved us by your love. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you bring us joy and forgiveness. Lord, have mercy.
Lord,
may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. May your people exalt forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restoration of glory from our adoption, we may look forward to confident hope to the coming of the resurrection through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the captain and the court officers had brought the apostles in and made them stand before the Sanhedrin, the high priest questioned them. "We gave you strict orders, did we not, to stop teaching in that name? Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and want to bring this man's blood upon us." But Peter and the apostles said in reply, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus, though you had him killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior to grant Israel repentance and forgiveness of sins. We are witnesses of these things, as is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." The Sanhedrin ordered the apostles to stop speaking in the name of Jesus and dismiss them. So they left the presence of the Sanhedrin, rejoicing that they had been found worthy to suffer dishonor for the sake of the name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will extol you, Lord, for you have raised me up and have not let my enemies rejoice over me. O Lord, you have lifted up my soul from the grave, restored me to life from those who sink into the pit. Sing psalms to the Lord, you faithful ones. Give thanks to his holy name. His anger lasts a moment, his favor all through life. At night come tears, but dawn brings joy. Hear, O Lord, and have mercy on me. Be my helper, O Lord. You have changed my mourning into dancing. O Lord, my God, I will thank you forever.
I will praise you, Lord, for you have
rescued me. A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, looked and heard voices of many angels who surrounded the throne and the living creatures and the elders. They were countless in number, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches, wisdom and strength, honor and glory and blessing." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea, everything in the universe, cry out, "To the one who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor, glory, and might forever and ever." The four living creatures answered, "Amen," and the elders fell down and worshiped.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, Jesus revealed himself again to his disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. He revealed himself in this way. Together were Simon Peter, Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, Zebedee's sons, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We also will come with you." So they went and got out in the boat, but that night they caught nothing. When it was almost dawn, Jesus was standing on the shore, but disciples did not recognize that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, have you caught anything yet?" And they answered him, "No." So he said to them, "Cast your net over the right side of the boat, and you will find something." So they cast it and were not able to pull it in because of the great number of fish. So the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he tucked in his garment, for he was lightly clad, and jumped into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, for they were not far from shore, only about 100 yards. Dragging the net with the fish. When they climbed out on shore, there was a charcoal fire with fish on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you just caught." So Simon Peter went out and dragged in the net ashore, full of 153 large fish. Even though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come, have breakfast." And none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they realized it was the Lord. Jesus came over, took the bread, and gave it to them, and in like manner, the fish. This was how the third time that Jesus revealed himself to his disciples after he had been raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" Simon Peter answered him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." Then he said to Simon Peter a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Jesus answered him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him a third time, second time, tend my sheep. Then Jesus said to him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was distressed that Jesus had said to him a third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to dress yourself and go where you wanted. But when you now grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will drag you, and they will lead you where you do not want to go. He said this, signifying the kind of death that he would, by how he would glorify God. And when he had said this, Jesus said to him, follow me. The Gospel of the Lord. In our second reading, it's taken from the book of Revelation, and it's one of those wonderful visions that John had. And it's very difficult to describe a vision. It's like trying to explain a rainbow. You can say, well, the sunlight hits the moisture particles within the atmosphere and is refracted in the different frequencies of the visible light, and they have, just be quiet and look at it, you really can't describe it. And there's a little bit of that in this episode, in this part of the book of Revelation. In our first reading, the apostles were very happy to suffer for the sake of Jesus. And when you first read that, you say, what's wrong with them? Why would you be happy that somebody's putting you in jail, especially when you don't deserve it? But here were the religious authorities of the time. And Jesus came and put everything, just turned it upside down, showed others that they are not the leaders that they should have been. In fact, the very word, the servant, it's kind of put apart. We stand apart. And that's all they would do, is study the Torah and just all these kind of different laws and regulations, etc. But here we have this wonderful breakfast scene. Now, I wonder if you ever come downstairs into the kitchen, what do you think your response would be if you saw Jesus making the French toast? Oh, I'll do that, Jesus. I'll do that. I'm the cook here. We'd be flustered if Jesus was doing that. But here is what the shepherd is doing. He's cooking for his disciples. And what a joy that must have been. And the three questions are really very, very interesting. We don't get the full impact the way the English translation goes, because we don't have different words like they do in Greek, like storge and agape, and they have different words for different kinds of love. But when you see the Greek, it's a little bit different. So Jesus asked them these questions. And, of course, we all know that ties back to the incident with the charcoal fire in the courtyard when Peter denied Jesus. And so he says, Peter, do you love me? Now, he's not asking that out of obligation. He's asking, do you love me? And Peter could have said no. It wouldn't have necessarily been a sin. But Jesus, he says, yeah, no, Jesus, you know that I love you. You know that.
Second time, feed my sheep, he says the first time. Second time, do you love me? And this time, when you look at the Greek word that's actually used, do you love me, it's really more of a word that refers to shepherds, shepherding. Jesus says, tend my sheep. It's a different love. He's beginning to show to Peter that you're going to have primacy among the apostles. You're going to be the shepherd. And of course, that third time, you love me. He said, Lord, you know that I love you. And it's easy to say these things. Jesus is pushing him a little bit to really hear from the depth of his soul. Peter, do you love me? And he says, okay, that's great. Because when you go older, somebody's going to tell you where to go. And of course, he's referring to the cross. This is what's going to happen to you. And it's going to cause your death. And Peter knew what Jesus was getting at. He had prophesied it himself. He went through that death and dying. So here it is. You're going to go through that as well, Jesus. And then we go back to that second reading with that absolutely glorious description of the Lamb on the throne. Obviously, the Lamb is Jesus. And I really want to encourage you today, when you go home, to go to Handel's Messiah and type in, Worthy is the Lamb. And several little things will come up in YouTube. And just, you've got to do this, with your speakers at least an 8.5. If you try to do this, like Muzak in the elevator, Worthy is the Lamb. Oh, jeepers. Just go take a nap, okay? Just don't even bother. But you got to really crank it up like that. And that whole page, blessing, honor, glory, it's just glorious music. And make everybody in your house listen to it. Well, my kids don't like it. Tough. They don't like spinach either, but you make them eat it. And some of you who are really cruel make them eat kale, all right? Remember, there's no such thing as kale in heaven. Thank God. Okay. But to really let that music touches, because music touches us on a much deeper level. A much deeper level. And if you went to a birthday party and it said, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, no. You got to sing that one. It just makes it really what it is. The words can be the same, but it's not the same when we sing them. So really, just turn that up like that and just enjoy. It's about a 6-minute long type part of music from Worthy is the Lamb all the way through to the great Amen. It was like 165 Amens in the Amen. So it's just one of those glorious things to listen to. But it's hard to describe the beauty of heaven. It's hard to describe what waits for us. What waits for us is not, having margaritas under your sunroof, okay? It's not that at all. It's absolutely glorious, and so glorious we can't really describe it. There are some things that help us, like great, great music. That finale for the Messiah. So I really would encourage you to do that. Or some people choose to be estranged from God. Be like the Sadducees and the Pharisees. Just kind of stay distant from God. Keep them out here. Well, I'll obey his commands because I don't want to go to hell. That's not love. That's not love. And every parent here knows when your children clean the room because you tell them to, that's not really what you want. You want something much more than that. You want them to be part of the family, taking responsibility for the home, taking care of your things. You have a lot more in it than just say, clean your room. And you don't want them to do it just to obey you. It's good that they do. That's not really what you want. You want something much more than that. And all the parents here know that. Well, God is very much the same way. He wants us to be truly engaged with the Lord, truly walking with Him. And so I'm going to ask you this week, I always like to give you something to do during the week. It makes it fun. Not, stop. Not always fun, that's true. But it can be very, very difficult. I think everybody in church here really loves Jesus. I don't think you're here not loving Jesus. I just don't believe that. I think you do. But sometimes we can short-circuit our love relationship with the Lord Jesus. So I want you to put your feet in Peter's shoes today. Imagine Jesus came to you this afternoon and says, you know, Michael, do you love me? Alice, do you love me? And ask you that three times. Yeah, Lord, you know I love you. You know I love you. He's going to say to you and to me to show that. Show that in your family. Show how much you love them. And think about it. How many times do you say to your children, I love you? How many times do you actually say that? Or is the last thing they hear from you is, brush your teeth, it's time for bed. You know, and that's okay. I mean, we should brush teeth. But what about, I love you? Boys and girls, children, when's the last time you gave your mom or dad a hug and a kiss? Well, you know, sometimes I'll ask people that in confession. I said, when was the last time you actually hugged your dad and gave him a kiss? And the boys are going, don't know. But how many times, dads, have you said I love you to your son? The last thing they should hear you when they're going to bed at night is, I love you. Even when they roll their eyes, even when they're not being very cooperative, even when they're even being nasty to their brothers and sisters and moms and dads, that's the last thing they should hear before they go to bed. Never let them go to bed without that. Never let them go to bed in silence. And, well, you know, Dad, I'm too old for that. No, you're not. Just tell them, no, you're not too old for that. And neither am I. So you have to kind of be conscious of this, because as we get into ruts. But to begin to talk like that in the family. Do you love me? Do you love God? And ask questions like that. So make an extra effort, because Jesus is telling to you as parents, me as pastor, to feed my lambs, feed my sheep. That's part of our job, to make that happen. And sometimes parenting can be trying, I'll use that word. Sometimes it can be tough. Sometimes you have to wait several years before you actually see the results. But that's not a reason not to do it. Put your hope in Jesus. And the last thing, what's the last thing you should say to your children before they go to bed? No. That was about enthusiastic. Let's try it one more time. What's the last thing your children should hear you say to them when they go to bed at night?
I love you.
Great. And then in the morning? In the morning, a little bit different in the morning. In the morning, when they're leaving the house, you just simply say, remember, God loves you. What do you say to him in the morning? And then they'll look at you, roll their eyes, and then you say, so do I. So they hear that in the morning and in the evening. Never let them go a day without hearing that. And then they'll say, Dad, you always say that. Mom, you always say that. I said, then you tell them, because I speak the truth. Let them hear that. There are too many voices. There are too many situations that really want to tear that apart. They deserve a lot more from us. So let's give it to them, even when they roll their eyes. It's okay. It's okay. They'll get over it. So will you. But they will hear some of the most important words they will hear that day. And they will remember, God loves me. My mom loves me. My dad loves me. Then they will become the men and women that God needs them to be and will be open to God's will, because they can be secure enough to know that no matter what, no matter what, you love them.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Through Christ's resurrection, new light, life, and peace have come into the world. With confidence, we offer our prayers and petitions to God, who changes all mourning into dancing.
For our Pope, who follows Simon Peter as the shepherd of the church, that he may care for his flock with love and compassion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For world leaders and politicians, that they may always remember to obey God and not humans as they create legislation and make difficult political decisions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are considering their vocations to single, married, or religious life, that they may always recognize Christ in their mindset, We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have recently been initiated into the church, and for those who are making their first communion this Easter season, that they may always find nourishment at the table of the Lord. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our faithful community, that we may tend to each other with the love of Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Theo, Phil Fulton, and Margaret Sakula, may they now reside in heaven in the company of all the saints and the loving embrace of Christ our Redeemer. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray in a special way at this Mass for all parishioners and for the prayers we now offer in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Merciful God, as we lift these prayers to you, we thank you for your blessings and ask you to continue to be a source of joy for us through Christ our Lord. Amen. And just a reminder that our second collection today is for the St. Jude Fund, which helps to care for the poor and the needy.
Please join us in singing our hymn for the preparation of the gifts, number 781. Lord, when you came to the seashore, number 781.
Thank you.
Let us pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may become acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Lord, accept the sacrifice at my hands, for the praise and glory of his name. Receive, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your exultant church, and as you have given the cause for such greatness, grant also that the gift we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to proclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him, the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of heaven, of the heavenly kingdom, are thrown open to the faithful. And for his death, is our ransom from death, and in rising, the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus the Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with the elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Vincent de Paul, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Holy Father, Daniel, our bishop, his assisting bishop Italo, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen, 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 amen. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our every evil. graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your holy will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer to those around us the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Singing our communion hymn number 943, Bread of Life from Heaven, found in your gather hymnal and your worship aid, number 943. join us in singing number 589, Lord Jesus Christ, number 589. Join us in singing number 510, Jesus Remember Me, number 510. Please join us in singing Regina Chaley, found in your worship aid.
Regina Chaley, let our way, hallelujah. We are quite well, we are still born.
Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those who were pleased to renewed by eternal mysteries may attain in the flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Reminder from our cardinal that all families in our parish across the archdiocese should have received the annual DSF mailing. On behalf of those served on all the different ministries and schools and jails and hospitals, those wonderful things that we can't just do as a parish, they receive funding from the Diocesan Services Fund. We thank you for your gifts. Each gift makes a difference. For those who have not yet responded to our archdiocese and the parish, really kind of get on that. This is something we can, it's just very, very good. With prayerful consideration and generous response, because they do things that we can't do. You know, with all these hospitals, we have to support 10 priests full-time just working in the hospitals. So we need to really help them and support them. Mother's Day is next Sunday, May 8th. You can honor our mothers, living and deceased, by picking up Mother's Day cards as you leave the church today. And tonight is the first Sunday of the month at Tuesday night prayer. It's really just a wonderful, wonderful prayer. It begins at 7:30 in the Chapel of Our Lady of Lourdes. Remember to pick up all your worship aids, and only thing left in the pews would be the books. Now, what are you supposed to tell your children last thing when they go to bed? And when they're leaving your house in the morning? Yeah. Right. Some of the people forgot the second part. But one of the ways Satan, you know, Satan is really tricky, because he's going to tell and tease your children to say, it's okay, Mom, Dad, I know you love me. You don't have to do that. That's what Satan will tell them. God will never tell them something like that. And he likes to tempt. He kind of wants us to get rid of that love language. He just doesn't love. He just doesn't like it, because all he can do is hate. We can love. And one of the ways we love, and one of the most important ways, is to say it. And husbands and wives, make sure you tell your spouse that you love them. Well, they know because I do all this work. I mean, stop. Every spouse likes to hear that. And you know that. Make it happen. The Lord be with you.
And
may Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ending. Let us go in peace. Alleluia.
Thanks
be to God. Alleluia.
Please join us in singing our closing hymn, number 574, Crown Him with Many Crowns.